each Sunday morning. We look at something in Baptist history, and we're studying 50 Baptists that we think that I think everybody should know. And in 1873, D.L. Moody, the American evangelist, sailed for Great Britain to preach at in some evangelistic meetings in Liverpool, England. And he took along with him, of course, his evangelist song writer and vocalist, Ira Sankey. And when they arrived in England, they couldn't help be disappointed when they discovered that the two pastors who had invited them to Liverpool had both passed away. So it was then that Mr. Moody opened additional correspondence, talked with a couple other people, and he found an invitation to conduct a meeting in York, England. However, when they made their way to York, they found that somebody told them that, well, this is a really bad time for evangelistic meetings because everybody's on holiday. So if you know in Europe, I think it's August now, but entire months are taken. The whole country shuts down. The whole area shuts down for 1 month while everybody takes a holiday. They call it vacation. And so, however, Moody felt that the Lord was having him preach there. So he distributed advertisements, and the meetings began. The first meeting, fewer than 50 people attended the session. But then Moody announced that there would be noonday prayer meetings, and they would begin the following day. Only six people attended those first meetings, but again, Moody felt that the Lord's hand of blessing was upon the effort. Mr. Sankey, his partner in those meetings, reported this interesting thing from those meetings. He said that it was one of those noonday meetings that a young minister, pastor of the leading Baptist church of the city, his face lighted up with light which I had not often witnessed before. He rose and he said, "Brethren, what Mr. Moody said the other day about the Holy Spirit for service is true. I've been preaching for years without any special blessing, simply beating the air and been toiling hard, but without the power of God upon me. For 2 days I have been away from the meetings, closeted with my master, and I think he has the victory now over my arrogance and pride. And I believe I've made a full surrender of all to him. And today I have come here to join you in worship and ask you to pray for me." That young Baptist preacher is a man by the name of F.B. Meyer, and he is our 26th person in Baptist, I think, that everybody should know. And Sankey went on to say that from that day on, marvelous success attended his preaching, F.B. Meyer's preaching. His name has become almost a household word in Christianity, and that was at that time and certainly today. But who was F.B. Meyer? Frederick Meyer was born in April of 1847 in London. He had a lengthy life of service to the Lord, and he passed away in 1929. He was saved at the age of seven. And then when he was 16, God called him to preach. He had been born into a family of wealth, but when he was 15 years old, his father experienced great business reversals, and it forced his family to leave their lovely home in Brighton. They had to return to London, and his father, being an honest Christian man, wanted to settle all his accounts honestly, so he did. But that left very little, next to nothing, for the family. So Meyer's silver spoon was gone, but his sterling character remained. And years later, Meyer would say that he gave thanks for this experience because it helped him discover the things that matter most, and that's what something like that will do. And in his ministry, that seemed to, I know that for much of his ministry, he turned to the poor. He started many missions, street missions, both here in the United States and in Britain. But that became his heart and his love. It was said that he'd rather have been with poor people than anybody else. And I think that's a great thing to say about a man like this who preached for the Lord. And in fact, it says that many times he was very sensitive about the love offerings. He's a very, very popular man in Baptist circles and preaching circles and in church circles, and he would receive offerings and honorarium, and more than once he returned love offerings that he thought were too large, very sensitive to the Lord about how much he should be paid. After his schooling, he graduated from London University in 1869. He entered into, as I said, his very long ministry, 63-year ministry, and he was one of the most unusual preachers of all of Great Britain. He would write over 80 books, 50 pamphlets. His ministry took him to many parts of the world, and as I alluded to, he had traveled at least 13 times to the United States to preach. And again, the Lord led him while he was over here to start many street missions with the local Baptist pastors in the cities that he preached in. The last 41 years of his life were pastoring in London. And I kind of chuckle at this, but if you realize what's going on here, he had maybe the unenviable position to pastor the other Baptist church in London in the mid-1850s, the other being Charles Spurgeon's church. And so imagine that, you know, and he handled that very well, as we'll see here. I'll mention something here. And of course, it goes without saying, God had a reason for him to have his small work there with that work that everybody else, of course, the rest of the world knew about Pastor Spurgeon. But he lived during the heyday of the gospel preaching in Great Britain. If you think about it, not just Baptists, but G. Campbell Morgan, Alexander White, Spurgeon, F.B. Meyer, these men all preached at the same time in Great Britain. Certainly the Lord blessed Great Britain at that time with unbelievable preachers. He told a few of his friends this story. I thought this was interesting. He said, referring to what I just spoke about, but he said, it was easy to pray for G. Campbell Morgan. He said, Spurgeon and Mr. Morgan were so popular and drew such crowds that our church caught the overflow and we had all we could accommodate. And so his attitude was wonderful about preaching, next door to Spurgeon, if you can imagine. And the thing that I would mention that a lot of historians don't even mention, but something kind of sad, but immediately after Spurgeon died, his church went through a very difficult time. And kind of a apostasy started to creep into the church, and his son was able to change that. But at the beginning, wasn't sure where that was going to go, and many of Spurgeon's members ended up going to F.B. Meyer's church. And so God did have a purpose for him, of course, being there, and that goes without saying. But F.B. Meyer has been shrouded in obscurity, mostly because of the timing of where he pastored. But here's a man who is committed to preaching the gospel in its fullness, and as one historian said, expressing the gospel in all its beauty. And he was one of the outstanding teachers, Bible teachers of his day. His devotional books continue to bless thousands. And I think of a couple books always when I'm trying to give you some ideas. But one of his works, which I think is a classic, which is very accessible and easy to read, is his Life of David. Very, very good work. And Life of Paul, actually. But Life of David is a classic, and I would recommend that to you if you if you're interested. That is, I'm sure, in our library. One quote that really stood out to me, and maybe God's using it in my life, but he had many quotes that are very important, but this I thought was very interesting about prayer. He said, the greatest tragedy of life is not unanswered prayer, but unoffered prayer. That was a very interesting quote. But F.B. Meyer, a very unique Baptist pastor and Bible teacher, he preached until the last 2 weeks of his life before the Lord took him home. And I want to thank the Lord this morning for F.B. Meyer and his ministry in Great Britain.